Andrei Marshakov as the last speaker of today. He will talk about string theory and then about
function. So, thank you very much. First of all, for the opportunity to speak here. Thanks to Giulio Alessandro, to other organizers. So I had sort of a
hard chat at this hard time. So we had to
speak about. So one of the options was a little bit related.
Well, maybe not a little bit.
Maybe not at all related with what Fabrizio told us about this cluster
stuff.
So I decided to choose another subject. So this is
from Petersburg.
And actually, I wanted to present and to listen for your remarks on some simple things
which are related to these chemicals,
their applications. Again, that's perhaps a stupid idea, since we just started the conference with a sort of a mini course by Maxim and Pietro, describing some very some features which include these objects.
But nevertheless, this is one application. We will go back to the history, from this historical background here, in the sense of two
phases of string theory.
Okay. So
one of them is
this concept of vertex. From supersymmetric quantum
chromodynamics,
which
were invented in a different context, but in the more modern context of supersymmetric gauge theory, which we all like to discuss, at least last 20 or 30 even years, they are supposed to realize one of these old mechanisms.
One of the big physical problems.
And
these
strings, sometimes this description becomes equivalent to certain sort of fundamental string theory on a fundamental theory on two-dimensional world sheet, where the corresponding model becomes conformal. And so these are related with all these collabia of science, as usual. And one part of that science I would like to discuss in more detail. So basically, this is the case of world sheet sigma models, which are conformal. So the case of two-dimensional supersymmetric and conformal field theory, and the issue of their Higgs and Coulomb branches of these theories, which in particular correspond to conifolds.
And moreover,
two dimensions, this is a very delicate and complicated issue. These Higgs and Coulomb branches are not well separated.
And the point is that
while the theory on the Higgs branch is
described by
gauge linear signal model,
the effective theory of the Coulomb branch seems to be
described by n equal 2 supersymmetric Liouville theory.
The issue which
we are trying to understand, how
this picture
is related
with
geometry, in particular with possible complex and Keller deformations, and especially the issue of complex deformation was not a priori an obvious one. It seems to me that we got an answer, and the point is from the point of view of physics. So to answer maybe addressed question by Maxim originally, who are you, physicist or mathematician? So that there are some possible legal explanations of
this kind of effect. So, well, yeah.
I didn't know that we have already a nice introduction. So what is the conifold? It's the simply singular three-dimensional complex manifold given by this equation. And it's well known that this equation can be regularized, the singularity can be regularized in two possible ways. One is just very nice from the fact that this is an equation of vanishing of a determinant of a 2 times 2 complex matrix. One can to come to a system of homogeneous linear equations. And the point is then that this matrix has everywhere rank 1, except for the points where all these variables equal to 0, where it has rank 0. And adding the solution of this equation to the initial data, you just blow up this point by the whole P1, since the solution to this equation is defined for lambda sub to a common factor, and it's everywhere except for 0, just you have a single point, but at 0 you have the whole P1, and this is a maybe simplest possible example of a non-compact collabial threefold. This is the total space of a bundle O minus 1 plus O minus 1 over P1 with a holomorphic collabial 3 form, which is just given by that formula, where xi is a ratio of lambdas. And from a solution of this system of equation, you can pass from one chart to another and indeed check that this form is holomorphic. This is one very nice resolution of a singular picture. And another one is just deformation, where you add something in the left-hand side, some complex, generally complex parameter. So then this is just a kind of a manifold related with SL2C, which has a compact three sphere inside. And actually not so much nice and not so much known is about that, about its physical applications. And also, what is the maybe one of the points is that this another deformation cannot be so simply generalized to generic case of beyond this threefold like the picture above. One about the application. So this is just one more application. What I wanted to use. Roughly, this is this conformal vertex strings in n equal 2 four-dimensional supersymmetric quantum chromodynamics. So where from this starts? This starts from very old years of, I would say, Landau-Ginzburg model, where first these vortex solutions were found. So strings in 4D is something non-trivial, some non-trivial configuration in two-dimensional plane. And so then it's prolonged along the third axis and somehow moves in time. And this old story with first Abrikosov, then Nielsen-Olesen string is that it's about superconductors, that magnetic field is kicked out, and so, or it is confined in a certain tubes. And if you have two monopoles, then in such picture, another the scenario of confinement of monopoles realize that these two monopoles are connected by a string, and so the energy, once you try to enlarge the distance, the energy grows proportionally to string tension. In supersymmetric theory, it's basically the same picture, while you only have some advantage that instead of solving the second order equations like Abrikosov did, you can solve the first order BPS equations and simplify your life though still they are not, say, even an equation for a simplest vortex cannot be solved analytically, since it's a kind of a bound case between the radial Liouville equation and the radial Sine-Gordon, which, as we all know, for example, from today's talk, is just a case of Penleve 3, which cannot be solved a part of without applying of the same methods from So this is called in condensed matter theory as a Meissner effect, and all that was about this Ginzburg and Landau stuff, some phenomenological theory of superconductivity. But then later on it became a fundamental theory of nature, which is called the standard model, based on the same principles. And moreover, the ideas of 70s, due to Polyakov, Toft, Mandelstam, was to dualize this picture and to change electric and magnetic charges. And if the magnetic object are in Higgs phase, then it will be given, it will give you a confinement of electrically charged objects, so the like confinement in QCD. That doesn't seem to be realized in this or that sense in any normal QCD, but in n equal to four dimensional supersymmetric QCD, this is indeed an effective mechanism of confinement, and due to developments after Seiberg and Witten, that scenario was realized here, as well as many other physical applications of previously formally found solutions, like instanton solutions, that indeed for many objects the non-perturbative effects, which completely change the perturbative picture, are based on this sort of non-trivial topological effects. So what about, well, these strings? So it's a long story. It's possible to discuss many, many times. So one, just for me, a particular case of this picture is that, well, actually, of course, such configuration is not literally this linear dependent potential for confinement, because this string, effective string, is thick. Since there is some mass parameter, then usually this mass parameter, it defines this thickness. And that's not really what one would like to have from general principles. However, there are certain particular conformal models when there are no mass parameters, and basically this string becomes thin. And so it's again many, many complications again of the way of describing this. This is from field theory point of view is realized only in strong coupling regime. And maybe the better picture is that in some particular cases it coincides with the fundamental string description, where Weltschild theory is obviously a conformal theory. So in that sense, the effective theory which you can get on a Weltschild can correspond to two-dimensional conformal theory. And in order to get consistent fundamental string picture, well known from, again, very old days, that some manifolds like Calabi-Yau's should appear here in the game. So this is what I would concentrate on. And I'll just try to write down at least some formulas. So the story is about, well, a part of what was the initial motivation for description of confinement. This is a separate sort of branch of this effective science grown up, which is called non-abelian vortex strings. And it simply means that this effective Weltschild theory contains non-abelian modes which correspond to some motions of a string in a flavor space. And as I said, as I tried to say, that this picture to be consistent with conformal theory and with this description, it should be some non-compact Calabi-Yau space. And in order to be critical, it should have also some fixed central charge of this Welch's theory in order to get critical string. And the action is a simple action. Here it's, as always, in this supersymmetric gauge theory, though supersymmetry is very important, but one forget about fermions when writing the formulas, just saying that all some kind of perturbative corrections are simplified due to fermions, but at least in weak coupling, the theory is, so the main effects is based on these classical solutions, and classical solutions are non-trivial for bosonic fields, so this is the action for bosonic fields. And by this, N and rho, these are two sets of Welch's fields with their charges plus and minus one here. Their number is equal in order for the theory to be conformal. And then here you add some vector multiplet, which can be combined into some twisted scalar sigma in two dimensions. This E-naught is gauge coupling, bare gauge coupling, which actually in this gauge linear sigma model ideology is you can tend to infinity, because just to realize this theory as a theory on a Higgs branch. And so this is this interaction term, which appear here after you add the twisted superpotential. So this is basically the action. And as I said, in order to fulfill some of my restrictions, we have here equal number of these N and rho fields with these charges plus and minus one. And in the classical case, this constant just goes to infinity.
Okay.
So, well, I just repeat this. This beta function for this Fayette-Leopoldus parameter beta is equals to zero in this case, because it's proportional to the sum of the charges. And, well, again, you can interpret it differently, or just say that it's originally a criteria for string to be fundamental, or it comes as an effective solution in a theory from four-dimensional theory with conformal invariance, four-dimensional conformal invariance. And in n equal to case, it means that the beta function for gauge theory coupling, which is just 2n minus nf, it equals to zero. So it's some particular solution in a theory with some particular amount of matter multiplets. So this is this four-dimensional requirement,
which
can be violated,
and which is violated, and then applies
to five dimensions. So that was very interesting, another subject. But here we just stay in this border. So the central charge then is just equal to the dimension of Higgs branch. And so we have this particular, with n equal 2,2, two-dimensional superconformal field theory. And so for critical string, this C hat equals to 3, which means that n equals to 2. And this is just the case of conifold. And actually, this is just the case of resolved conifold. So, because in general situation, since this D-term condition looks as follows, here it's a real part of the complexified Fayette-Leopoldus parameter by two-dimensional theta angle. And for, again, like we heard on this this mini course, so for generic beta non-equal to zero, either n or rho is not equal to zero, dependently on the sign. And then necessarily from Lagrangian, the vacuum expectation value of sigma equals to zero, since it becomes massive, because either this or that field gives mass to sigma. Then when you look at this equation, this is a typical case of this Hamiltonian reduction. So since you have n such fields and such fields, so the total amount is to n. This is one real condition. Another real condition is given by the phase, or you can, as usual, remove this and just consider the complex reduction by C star with certain stability conditions. But anyhow, totally the real dimension in twice to n minus one, or complex dimension is just to n minus one. And so geometrically, this is a total space of this sum of all minus one bundles over Pn minus one, and the kinetic term for these two fields gives you some Keller form normalized to this parameter beta. And well, this is a two-dimensional for n equal two. This is a two-dimensional cycle inside this geometry, and so this is exactly the resolved conifold. So a generic situation. The question is what happens when beta goes to zero, and we formally approach the point of a singular conifold. What happens there? Any questions?
Okay.
Now, again, very similar to what happens in the case well known of four-dimensional theory, though it's, well, maybe here it's not even so strange to apply four-dimensional analogies, but when beta equals to zero, this determined condition allows a solution where both n and rho equals to zero. So some kind of a singular point. And then at this singular point, a Coulomb branch in principle can develop. So you can get the expectation value of sigma non equal to zero. So what can we say about this Coulomb branch? So first of all, that this is a very delicate point in 2D. There is in two dimensions, there are these large infrared fluctuations, and there is no strict border between Hinks and Coulomb branches. The question is, can we get any strict geometric definition of what corresponds geometrically to this physics? And there is a common belief in the literature. I cannot even present here this enormous amount of citations to various papers. That would correspond to another option, that is to deformed conifold situation. So then, again, how our colleagues were saying, to this question, it is possible to try to answer physically or mathematically. And obvious idea for physics would be to, once you have massive, at this point, you have massive n and rho fields, you can integrate them out and study effective field theory. Well, one would expect, and I would try to convince you that it's indeed n equal to Lie will, and that it will be an effective field theory on this Coulomb branch. But what can we say about it? This first question. Second question is to study possible complex. Yeah, and this is actually, as you see, here everything is independent on this amount of matter fields. And actually, of course, the most easy way is to use n to infinity limit to study this first Lagian approximation, which is well known to give reasonable results which can be prolonged and back to n equal to 3, or even n equal to 2, or maybe here even to n equal to 1. But anyhow, in this large n limit, this is the very obvious idea what you can do. And then, well, you can also study the complex deformation in generic situation and try to understand the field theory origin. And again, what we could try to predict, and what is indeed true, that the picture will be very different than n equal to and n greater or equal than 3. And somehow to compare, can we match what happens here? So, well, first one, Lagian renormalization, an obvious thing. if you consider the kinetic term, so we integrate out this Enendro fields, and we get an effective theory for a vector multiplet. So this is just kinetic terms for gauge field, this sigma scalar and D field. And in large N, it's old results, I think even maybe before Witten, it was Divecki, Dada, people like that. This is the three normalization. That this ineffective theory, this gauge multiplet, starts to be live. So this is one loop renormalization of a gauge coupling. It's just given by this simple diagram where external lines correspond to the fields from gauge multiplet. And here this N row and their super partners run. There are two vertices, so it's each contribution is proportional to Q squared. And in contrast to Fayolle-Leopold's term, when you take sum of this Q squared, you obviously get to N. And so this is just a normalization, and more or less by dimensional reasons, it can be just 1 over modulus of sigma squares. This is an exact result in large N. And then you can put as before this E naught to infinity. This term disappears, but this effective coupling inverse proportional to square, so proportional to square modulus sigma, it results here in this section. So very simple and obvious computation, which of course, well, at least from my point of view, everyone can trust. No? So what it results? Then originally we had these kinetic terms. Here I briefly wrote it in terms of an integral over superspace of the superfield sigma. This is not a sum, yeah, it's just the superfield of this multiplet. And it runs to n times such Keller potential. So log sigma bar log sigma. Or for this lowest component sigma, when you substitute it by some parameterization, it just gives you the kind of a free field theory, free field theory action. What is here? So here, what did I do? So first of all, this Y is a compact scalar, which lives on a circle of radius proportional to some, well, parameter Q. This phi is non-compact. So this is this real Liouville field. H is two-dimensional metric on Wild sheet. I restored it just to consider it an effective theory on an arbitrary Wild sheet. And then, like in many cases, like for example in bosonization of Desimino models, you get here this linear dilaton proportional to this radius, proportional to two-dimensional curvature, where only this Liouville part, compact part disappears, only this field appears here. So that I would call by Fagan-Fuchs dilaton. So the term prolongs stress energy tensor two-dimensional theory. And as we saw just now, at large n, this Q is proportional to square root of 2n. Just somehow to fix the parameter. And then, if you include here, again, a twisted superpotential with this field sigma, it completes it to n equal to Liouville theory. So this is, well, consistent, for example, with the fact that the dimension of the sigma field is equal to 1/2. This is, well, first of all, that is, you can integrate it over the superspace. Second, it's the dimension of this operator, which is consistent with this Fagan-Fuchs stress energy tensor. So, and third, of course, it's consistent because this sigma is a part of a vector multiplet, so it
came out of a reduction of polynomial,
and so it has the same, so it dimension is not zero because it's the same like of a vector field. Yeah, so what, yeah, and this is this, as I said, this is just technical tool. You see that you can, in a theory on a curved, on a Wild sheet with arbitrary metric, you have just to rescale the signal by determinant, and it gives you from anomaly this contribution. So effective theory at Lagesson is a living theory. Now, what about possible exact equivalence? So here we have a conjecture, which is already not as reliable as what I said at Lagesson, but still I believe it is correct, that actually the effective theory in the infrared on the Coulomb branch is exact even beyond Lagesson if we slightly correct this relation. So if we say that exactly q squared is twice n minus 1, at n goes to infinity is the same as 2n, and here then the central charge of the Liouville theory, which was written on previous slide, just simply computed is 1 plus, so this c hat is central charge divided over 3, so and then consists of so here would be 3, yeah, so it's 1 from Y field plus 1 from a fermion, complex fermion, plus 1 from this field. So altogether is 3 plus 3 Q squared divided by 3 is just that. And that under such identification, it corresponds to the central charge of the conformal theory on the Higgs branch, which is sort of, well, explanation, clarification, as you want, that there is no actually real distinction between the Higgs and Coulomb branch in this case. This is first part, and second is that what I would try to say in what follows, that the issue of complex deformations can be tried to be understood via this effective Liouville description.
This is review lecture. All day, when I was a story about normal two-dimensional Liouville.
Yes.
Polyakov argued that Liouville could be different in like certain dimensions. You could always interpret Liouville as some additional dimension. So my question is that in this theory, if you got so it's like string theory with additional Liouville now. Can I think about it a little bit more like additional dynamical dimension?
It's a good question. I don't know. Because, yeah, I understand what you say. Yeah, so originally when Polyakov introduced Liouville, he introduced it, you have some Bosonian matter theory, you integrate over the metal field, you get this Liouville theory. Then later on, another picture, yeah, this is mostly due to David Distel-Kavai, etc., that you can treat a Liouville, yeah, as a kind of a time dimension with this, again, this dilaton time dependence, and that this is a sort of a consistent theory, which comes back to critical, where C is 25 and 1, yeah. I don't know, Grish, actually, about here. I didn't. Well, it's two-dimensional. Yeah, it's not QCD, really. It's... Ah, four-dimensional. I see.
So, from my understanding, logic was you start from four-dimensional to Kaponov field theory. Then you look for the solution.
I see. I see.
Now my question is if I
follow. I kind of have this effective, yeah, for extra dimensional interpretation, then more in spirit of this idea is QFT, etc. Thank you. Well, we didn't think about that. Pasha, did you? See? thank you. Good remark. So. Now, what about these complex deformations? The simplest stuff. How we describe it? So, we have these n-row fields of matter, yeah, from 1 to n. It's natural to one has charge plus 1, another has charge minus 1, to unify them in a sort of a set of mesonic variables. And then, for these mesonic variables, you obviously write down an equation, this conifold point, just by the sense that since this is a matrix of rank 1, its determinant equals to 0, and by substituted in set of explicit coordinates, you get this equation of a conifold, which can be further deformed, and the question is it to Coulomb branch, by writing down here some epsilon, so where there is no longer such a representation. Well, I don't know any yet strict answer to this question, but just the case is the first thing we one have to think is it an analog for, so this is the case of n equal 2, but what happens for generic n? If we have n greater than 2, then situation becomes far more complicated. But generally we have this sort of amount of equations, they are dependent for n squared variables. The manifold is not complete intersection, so its dimension is just 2n minus 1, it's greater than that. And the question about its possible complex deformation is not so trivial. So what happens? So first of all, well, what we want to do? We want to deform the equations and then which look like for arbitrary n in this way. So these are just all minors of this matrix, yeah, since by definition they vanish. And we're looking for some small deformation where instead of the zero in the right hand side, it stays some quantity. So this is, of course, well, we want to see whether such equation has a solution at some other point, moved small point, then we linearize it and get a kind of overdetermined system of equations for these deformations, which either has some non-trivial solution or doesn't have a non-trivial solution. In order for it to have a non-trivial solution, it is clear from here, that's what we have in the right-hand side, yeah, so this is in the first order in this epsilon, I can cancel it, so the right-hand side should be in the image of some matrix constructed from the just gradients of these relations after substituting there the explicit representation for mesonic variables. This is, for example, in order to, this is done in order to get rid of a possible trivial deformations proportional to these equations themselves. There is a, delicate point maybe about zero. So in the zero picture, is not like in generic points, but anyhow it is, we believe that we can forget about the subtlety for a moment. So the consistency is that this deformation functions should lie in the image of this operator, which is just some matrix, polynomially dependent on n and rho, for non-vanishing n and rho. And in order to describe this space of deformations explicitly, we construct an operator, some operator D1, just in order to get so that the product of D1 times D0 is zero, so that this image of D0 lies in the kernel of this D1 for non-zero n and rho. The question, whether we can learn something about non-trivial deformation in this way. So, first, so this, it turns out that, of course, this D1 is not unique. It can be constructed, well, maybe in many other ways, but probably the simplest choice is when it is linear in this n and rho variables. So, and what is written here is just the sum over the permutation of three elements with the sign of a permutation is proportional to this n, and here are the corresponding delta symbols. So this is the formula which one can write for this D1 operator, and one have also to exclude the trivial deformations which can be removed by polynomial change of coordinates. And so actually these deformations are proportional to the operator D0 we had already. So this equation, yeah, should be considered as an equation between polynomials, which is very important. So, the summary of what I try to say is that all deformations belong to the kernel of D1, while trivial deformations lie in this image of this denote operator. And so it means that although locally this is just the same objects, except for the zero point, but it is possible that they do not coincide once we consider this in the whole space of polynomial functions. And then the non-trivial deformations are, of course, described by, of course, here is the opposite. Kernel of D1 divided by image of D0. So, the naive, I would say, example, which is, however, the most crucial, is example of n equals to 2, where D1 is just equals to 0. And it has a very big kernel. And the image of, well, denote consists just of these monomials of degree 1 in n and 1 in rho. So kernel is this space of polynomials just when of arbitrary degree where all this degree of n polynomial in n coincides with the degree of polynomial in rho, while image is the same when these degrees are greater or equal than 1. Otherwise, in the space of polynomials, you can do nothing. And when you take a factor, here, by the way, it's written correctly. And so this is just one-dimensional complex space. So this is the, this deformation corresponds to the deformed conifold. Now, for n greater or equal than 3, situation, well, is not so simple. You have to use the formula. And you can prove that actually, in this case, always these two guys coincide. And in order to prove this, you have to use the lemma, just that some simple commutative algebra, that the general solution to such equation for some number of variables, which actually have applied this lemma for different values of m for polynomial functions, is just given by such formula where omega is some x-dependent matrix antisymmetric. That can, this lemma can be proved by induction, and then using it, you actually see that this is always the case beyond n equal 2. So the short answer is that
this manifold, which you get the singular
manifold, the singular point of a Higgs branch, cannot be deformed for n greater or equal than 3, but it can deform for n equal to 2. So, is there any explanation from the Liouville side? So, just I repeat, so here, what I tried to demonstrate before. So, we computed this as an effective infrared action for the n equal to supersymmetric Liouville theory. Here, it's all contributions with this term, this fermionic terms, and this is the interaction. Yeah, it contains few fermion exponential pieces and few bosonic. So this is a
particular case of so-called fine Liouville theories.
With especially if you once you bosonize these two-dimensional fermions, and many methods of, well, not many maybe, some methods developed in the study of ordinary Liouville theory can be extended to such multifield theories. So the central charge, as I said, is equal to 3 plus 3q squared, it's obvious from here. Then this is 2m minus 1 with this value of parameter. And there is another non-trivial statement, which is intensively used in study of this n equal to Liouville, that it appears as a mirror description of a supersymmetric version of two-dimensional black hole, or the coset theory, SL2R or K over U1, where this K is twice divided by Q squared. It's equal to 1 to n minus 1. In the case where Liouville interaction or singularity of this metric is negligible, so far from the end of the cigar, or in the value here it would be large positive phi, where this potential vanishes, this is just t duality over the compact scalar direction. But well, generally it's a complicated subject again.
Not so simple as the
effective field theory computation, so that you can trust it. Okay, and so this is just a set of Feynman diagrams to reproduce this Liouville action. I presented for completeness. So you see that here all external lights correspond to vector multiplet, and basically, so this is the kinetic term, and these are the interaction terms. Any questions, Julio?
No, about the black hole.
About the black hole, yes, maybe you know something in contrast to me. Okay. So now we started from n going to infinity, but nevertheless there are two important particular cases why I said that here this computation, which is exact in China or in India, can be prolonged to smaller values. So n equal 1, yeah? Then this q squared is just 0, or this dual level of this dual black hole coset goes to infinity. And actually, this is a free theory. So naively, it is, you can see that it's actually not a very trivial statement as well. Though you can, well, see that this dilaton vanishes, but here is somehow q in this matter. But in the black hole picture, it's maybe more transparent, since this is the metric of this black hole in some radial coordinate. And this limit corresponds to the limit when you can just replace this tangents by r, and so you get a metric in a radial coordinate on a complex plane. One particular case seems to fit in. So Kone fold corresponds to n equal 2, then q is square root of 2, and well, k equal to unity, and this is very well known values of parameters corresponding to so-called self-dual case, which is distinguished from all others. And so this is one first remark, that in this n equal 2, we have some distinguished case, while for n greater or equal to 2 is some generic situation corresponding to this dual level less than unity. So, more particular. As I said, that phi goes to infinity where interaction is negligible, you can just consider the primary operators in this theory, like exponents, yeah, like in free field theory. So where this is non-compact and this is compact direction. Sorry for stupid notation. So this j is a quantum number, while this I is just square root of minus one. So I'm always very critical to notations of other speakers, but God does not allow you to relax. And so, in this theory, due to non-trivial dilaton, when you consider the space-time interpretation, you should take into account that there is a string coupling, phi-dependent string coupling. And so such operator corresponds to wave function, which to construct it, you have to multiply by this string coupling. And so this phi, psi, space-time, wave function, it behaves in this limit like that. So where basically this g, which is not square root of minus one, is shift by one half. So you see that in this case, this value of j quantum number equal to minus one half is distinguished because this term disappears and you do not have grown exponent in any region. Well, this is at large phi, but nevertheless, and you have just a kind of a plane wave in compact theory, which correspond, well, to the operators which are logarithmically normalized states. Generally, this is not the case, and you, in dual, for example, description, people often use such formula where, apart from this compact part, you have a contribution of actually two terms with direct and reflected exponent, like in this mini superspace approximation to Liouville theory, with some coefficient, which is the reflection coefficient, and it is constructed from gamma functions, so it's proportional to such combination. And it is very important, well, first of all, that it is believed to have such expression for the fields in the spectrum, and second, that actually this reflection coefficient is related with the two-point function. This is this normal Liouville ideology. So, what about the Liouville operator? So, the Liouville interaction operator, this sigma, if we write it in such term like I use for the operators in the spectrum, then it formally corresponds to the values of G equal to M, first of all, minus 1 over Q squared to minus K over 2, or minus 1 divided to 2N minus 1. And for N equals to 1, this is exactly G equals to minus 1 half. So this is the first case which from Liouville's side definitely distinguish the Kronefeld. So this Liouville operator just fits to the spectrum. That never happens. So in normal Liouville theory, this is the case of C equal to 1, or C Liouville equals to 25. Something is known about that, but I cannot say that for me too much. Well, second, that if you consider this correlator of sigma with sigma star, sigma bar, well, this bar you have to, in order to take right contributions for the compact direction, then it's non-vanishing in the case of n equal to 2, just because this all gamma functions vanish for minus j is equal to j plus 1. For m equals to j, if you can prolong this formula out of the spectrum, then this is a gamma of zero in the denominator with a pole. So it means that this coefficient has zero, and it is possible to believe that otherwise this two-point function vanishes. So which means that actually there is no Coulomb branch. So you can try to go there, but this Liouville potential pretends you to going far, except for the case of n equal 1, where this Coulomb branch exists. And also, this dual black hole picture is sick for such fractional values of k, because this size of strings becomes compared to the size of, well, Schwarzschild radius, or I don't know, to the size of universe, whatever. So, just what are my conclusions up to now? So that this gauge linear sigma model, as we all know, describe the Higgs branch of this effective two-dimensional conformal theory. For n equal to 2, this is just resolved Kronefeld with some generic Fayolle-Oppel's parameter. And at beta equals to 0, this Coulomb branch can open up. If it opens up, then the effective theory is this n equal to 2 Liouville theory, the infrared, with conjecturally this q squared exactly equal to twice n minus 1. Then this Coulomb branch corresponds to deformed Kronefeld and n equal to 2. We have deformations, and there are no deformations at n greater or equal than 3. And the only simple explanation I can suggest by now is that only for n equal 2, this Liouville operator is on the spectrum, and this is indeed a distinguished case from the world sheet point of view. So basically, I think that I can finish here. Thank you for attention. And if you have questions or better remarks, I would be happy to hear.
What do you expect and what kind of behavior is this sigma model?
Well, I just have only very simple, you know, picture from a school of this шарик на пружинке, I don't know how to say that, it tries to go there, yeah, but then it is forced to come back. And this is, well, there were many, many explanations. If again, read the literature, it's something terrible. I cannot read, but like Waffle at some point was trying to describe a picture where there are some holes on the string weld sheet, and then partially this is a Coulomb branch, partially this is a Higgs branch, just somehow interrelated. And there are many, 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 many other interesting applications. I cannot trust whether this is correct or not. What I can trust, I try to present.
Paradox, because you start with a very beginning kind of arguing the string theory should describe from the cap regime of the gauge theory.
Yes.
And normally people are presenting like one example, you go to large and limit. The large and limit kind of see that this kind of wall sheets naturally builds up to the full target, the quantum.
Yeah, but what is
but
it's different M. Yeah, that's the number of it's number of flavors here. It's just not it's number of flavors actually. Well, but okay, yeah, that's complicated. Once this is number of flavors, it's related with the number of colors because this is conformal theory, even from this perspective, yeah? So large N, yeah, it's indeed large N, and so what?
No, but it seems like you're saying that n equal, at least in this particular scenario you described.
Yeah, what I'm saying.
You cannot go to large n, but it's exactly large n limit, and one would expect to have.
No, you can go to large n, but just on Higgs branch everything is very fine, but just this Coulomb branch doesn't open up. In that sense, you say that, as you say, at large n you don't have this extra Liouville direction. Okay, we don't have it, but we see, and this is this mathematical argument, pure mathematical argument, that you can study just the space of polynomial deformations and see that it's empty. No, not so bad, yeah. But of course, I understand that it's some points are very weak.
Consequences of this description. So, for example, you are saying for n equals 2, there is a description of world sheet theory, effective theory. What information can you extract from this?
Well, it's also consistent that because only for n equals to 2, you have a description in terms of a critical string. Okay. You have the right central charge of this theory in order to add it to four dimensions to get 10. Yeah, and so no, this is one of the critical dimensions. Then for other n, for large n actually, there are no nice applications. So in that sense, this negative result is also a physically good result because otherwise it would be strange. But okay, but maybe I didn't get what is your question?
The point of view of initial theory,
which one? In four dimensions, yeah. So this is just a string solution in this conformal supersymmetric QCD at strong coupling. So from the point of view of this initial supersymmetric QCD, you basically cannot say anything.
Yeah, but like I'm not asking about the Lagrangian description of QCD, but like at least about the, what, for example, you have like spectrum of operators in this world theory for n equals 2.
Yeah.
What spectrum of this operator?
I see. There are some answers. Yeah, for example, that this, I think, Liouville deformation, it corresponds to some baryon in this theory. There are some statements about that. I'm now not ready to answer.
So, can you
imagine some results? It is related with these normalizability conditions. Because many states which are not normalizable, they cannot appear in four-dimensional theory. But those which are normalizable, and there are very few of them, they can show up.
So they can be compared to like this Sapir-Whitten description?
Well, that I don't really know. I think they can be compared, yes.
Yes, your string theory was
critical. In this, in conifold case, yes. In conifold case, it's critical, yes.
If I'm, maybe I'm mistaken, but I remember that paper by Mr. Schiffman and Lucien, talking about n equals to theory, not conformal. N equals to conformal. N equals to semantic theory, but it might be conformal.
I'm saying that here is the same h. Moreover, I'm saying that they're both equal to zero. Both equal. Yeah, yeah, but here they both equal to zero. Generic situation. It's generic match, of course. Just more than they're both zero. Yes. There is some statement. Well, again, I'm afraid to cite, as not ask me, going back to Palczynski, whatever, that in that case, this local Wilson theory is not UV complete. You have to add some terms that goes blah, blah, blah. And that's why this criticality is important, because in critical case, you can say more than that.
Okay. If there are no further questions, let's thank Andrei for nice talk.